Welcome to another video from Far North Bushcraft and Survival. My name is Lonnie, and behind the camera is my wife Connie. And in this video, we're going to be talking about tent wood stoves. What type of a stove do you want, need? What type of metal should it be made out of? How big should it be? Let's get into it. Okay, these next four stoves are going to be breakdown titanium, compact, lightweight. Lightweight can be relative. These first three are from the manufacturer Pomali. Now let's get to discussing the unique features of each one. Now this one has side glass in it on both sides. Do you want side glass? Well, you know, side glass is nice until it gets sooted up, gets dirty, and then it may burn off. It may partially burn off now and then. But for the most part, in my experience, the side glass, it pretty much stays sooted up for the most part. So it's not as nice as one would think it would be. However, the glass helps protect the stove from warping. Oftentimes these long sheets will twist, or they'll warp in or out. The glass prevents that. Now, one place where I do really like the glass, overall I like it on the side, but it can be a bit of a, it can cloud up and cut off your view. I do like it in the door, especially well, because it tends to stay cleaner longer, and you can watch the fire. Okay, now, as far as stove pipes, each one of these four breakdown titanium stoves use a titanium foil pipe. This is the entire pipe. You take this off, roll the pipe out lengthwise, and then, you know, it's rolled this way, you roll it out, and then roll it this way, and it becomes your stovepipe. And then you put rings on the outside to keep it held in place. Now this stove here, okay, one of these is the T1 perspective, I believe that's this one, and one of these is the Timber 3. Now I'm not sure which is which, I don't remember. But this one has one solid side, and it is, what makes this one unique is it is a fold-in. It all folds. So, just like that. So when you get to your campsite, it is a quick, very quick assemble to get it up and running. Okay, we are good to go. Plus the legs. All right, let's move on to the next one. Now this is also from Pomali. This is called the T-Brick, T-Brick Max. As you can see, it has side shelves, and I have come to really appreciate side shelves. I really like them. Now, one thing unique, let's take these side shelves off for now. One thing unique about this stove is that it's a double decker. essentially, it's two stoves in one. There you go. If you want to go lighter weight, you can use it as a single stove like this. You can then use glass on this side and glass on this side, or metal, solid metal and solid metal. It's your choice. As you can see, I assembled it with the two glass sides on one side in this case. Now, one advantage of using it double-decker is not only can you get more wood in it, but you can get, it's got a lot more radiating surface to heat the tent. Now, that brings in up another subject. How large of a stove do you want? In cold weather, I'm a fan of bigger is better. You can have a little tiny stove. You can have a stove smaller than this, and you can have that thing burning red hot. And you're not going to be near as warm as if you have a very large stove burning very slowly. The large mass of the large stove will more effectively heat the entire area of the tent. Okay, now that's the Pomali stoves. Let's go on to this one. This is made by Seek Outside. Now, I said before, one advantage of the glass sides is it keeps a stove from warping. Is warping bad? Well, not necessarily. If you'll notice this stove here, it's warped. I don't know if you can see the sides here, how it, you know, it kind of buckled in a little bit right in here. It still works great. It doesn't affect the operation at all of the stove. These breakdown stoves will continue to burn very effectively, even if they're warped. Now, if you're wanting heavy duty, these stoves down here would be a much better choice than this one. If you notice, this stove is quite a bit larger, which is an advantage. Size, like I said before, is nice to have. But this stove is extremely light. This is a type of stove that you could backpack. This is the large size from Seek Outside. You can get smaller ones that are lighter yet. Okay, then that's it for the titanium. Let's go on to stainless steel. This is Winterwell. A Winterwell Nomad. Nomad View, I think it's called. And it has side shelves as well. These are very heavy duty side shelves. These side shelves are also used as handles for carrying the stove. This stove has glass on one side. This is a solid side. And as you can see, it is warped. Maybe you can see. It is warped, but once again, that warping doesn't affect the operation at all. It will continue to work just fine. Now, anything else unique about this? Well, this is a bit unique. This, there we go. I've got the pipes and floor grate in here. But you can open that up if you so desire. I typically do not desire to have this open. In fact, personally, I would rather it didn't have this. But some people like it. Now, the differences between stainless steel and titanium. Stainless steel, these heavy ones like this one, really heavy duty, and you'll probably be passing this on to your grandkids. Stainless steel will last a long, long time. Titanium, I believe that it is very long lasting as well, but it will, all stove metals will burn through eventually. And the titanium, they're made of a much thinner grade material for their lightness. And so I haven't had the titaniums. I'm fairly new to them, only a couple of years. So I don't really know how long they'll last, but I think they will last a long time as well. Okay, now we go on to these two stoves here. These are from Russian Bear Market. Several unique features on them. The door operates like this. The air intake operates like this. Now, am I a fan of that? No, not really. I don't care for the door. It works fine. It works fine, but I prefer a larger square opening for getting the wood in and working. Now, these have metal sides. Why do they have these metal sides? They are made for both of these stoves. They're made for putting rocks on top and using as a sauna heater. The stainless steel metal will prevent it from rusting, and they're made as a sauna heater. Or say you want to put this sideways in your tent, parallel to the side of the tent. This is a heat shield that will help protect the side of the tent, help keep the side of the tent from becoming overheated. Of course, you'll still want to watch and maintain safety in all circumstances. Make sure that your tent is not overheated, tent material. However, these side shelves will come off. It has glass on the side, and these side shelves help protect that glass. Now, another unique feature of this stove is a baffle inside. Take a look. Now that baffle, if you'll notice, the stovepipe is in the front of the stove. The reason for that is the baffle starts right about here, right about in this area, against this end. It goes back to about here, about in here somewhere. So the fire, the smoke, exhaust from here will go back up over this baffle, come up front and up the pipe. As you can see from the coloration of the stove, right in here is the hottest part of the stove. This also has a heat shield in the back to prevent overheating from the back, and it also has a built-in heat shield underneath the stove. Now, the next stove is the same exact stove with the same exact features, but it's a larger stove. So this is my favorite stove now for heating my larger tents in colder weather because of its size. Okay, now we've discussed titanium, we've discussed stainless steel. Stainless steel is going to be much cheaper. Let me rephrase that. It's going to be much less expensive than titanium. The reason for titanium is, of course, the lightweight for backpacking, for compactness. Now, let's get into the homemade stoves. This one You know, these are expensive stoves, the titanium, the stainless steel. But do you need to spend that much, really? No. You can make stove. This one, as you can see, is made from a 5-gallon bucket. Air intake, feeding door, and it works great. My wife and I have used this quite a bit, and it's a good stove, good little stove. Now here is a stove that my friend Charlie, also known as 8K Trapper, YouTube channel 8K Trapper, Charlie made this and gave it to me, and that's where I got the idea. I got the idea from Charlie on how to make the door and the air intake for this 5-gallon bucket stove. As you can see, this is made from a 55-gallon barrel. Charlie cut off the bottom of the barrel, and he cut the barrel right along the rib, this first rib down from the top or the bottom, whichever way you want to go. He cut the bottom off of the stove, he slipped the bottom in here, and then he peened over this rib edge to make a tight seal, and it works excellent. How much would this cost? Well, you'd have to buy these two hinges, you'd have to buy these two bolts, and that's about it. $5. Less than $10 for a nice hefty stove. Now here's another stove. This is a stove that I made in one of my videos, and you can see how to make this stove yourself by watching this video right here in the link. And for those of you who don't see the links, I'll leave a link below the video in the video description. This is made from ductwork. And yes, all you safety Nazis, this is galvanized metal. Now, is galvanized metal dangerous? No, not if you know what you're doing. When you make this, before you put it in a tent, you want to burn this galvanizing. Burn it off outside where the breeze can blow the toxic fumes away before putting it in a tent. Now, I just slipped this in here just to show how that works. Another feature I made for this is the side shelf. You can see how I riveted on here a couple of tabs. I bolted a couple of triangle pieces, and makes a nice little shelf, pretty heavy duty. The legs fold in like this. They can also be used as a carry handle to carry the stove. Okay, now this stove is rather unique in that it's a 30-gallon barrel. It's either a 25 or a 30, and I don't remember which. Using a 55-gallon barrel stove kit. I put this together over 20 years ago, and this has been my go-to stove for heating my wall tents and my larger winter tents. The gasketing is no longer staying in place on this. I don't use this stove anymore because it is burnt out. But I keep it around because it has been such a useful stove for probably 20 years. Now, finally, last but not least, is this unique stove. This is an old military stove. I bought this stove probably 40 years ago. It is very compact. As you can see, it is three-legged. Well, two-legged, actually. These legs for the front. And then for the back, this is part of the stovepipe. You slip it on, slip it off. And it becomes a leg for the stove as well. The exhaust exit out near the top, out the back and up. This was my first tent stove that I ever bought. The stove pipes materials. This one, as I showed you before, the breakdown titanium stoves use a titanium foil pipe. Now, oftentimes when you're camping, the wind can be really whipping the tent around, especially if it's a taller tent like a tipi. That tent might be whipping around. You might need to anchor this down. Well, that's where a spark arrestor of this sort can be useful. You slip it over the top of the stove pipe. Let's see if we can get this on while it's rolled up like this. Okay. And then you can guy it out and hold this in place. That way it'll keep the stove pipe firm, and the stove pipe won't be rocking around too and pull out from the stove. Now, this stove pipe here, several of these, this one and the one next to it, these are actually galvanized duct. It works fine, but again, you'll want to take it outside and burn it off first before you put it in a tent. Now, the next stove there, the next three, their stove pipes are stainless. They're made of stainless steel. Now, spark arresters, homemade stoves. You have to buy a real fancy spark arrester? No. This is what I did. I got some hardware cloth, 1/4-inch gap, and I just had a sheet of it, folded it over, and then rolled the side a couple of times, rolled the top a couple of times. Then when you get to where you're going, you just pop it out like this, slip it over the top of the pipe. Of course, this one is too big for this size pipe. It's made for a larger pipe. And then just set it on there, and it works really well. The large size is an advantage. The tall, it's an advantage, because oftentimes if you make it too short, this is going to carbon up and start choking off your stove. So if it's a very large one, when this carbons up, the smoke will just go up further, and it'll last quite a while. Now, while we're discussing stove pipes, you probably can't see, but they tend to build up carbon inside the stove pipe. What do you do about that while you're out camping? How can you remove that carbon? Well, a lot of times I'll just whack off a spruce branch, stick the butt of the branch in here, and pull it through. That'll pull loose a lot of the loose soot. Now, what that can't get, in the past I've cut a stick, and I've just run a stick, a branch. Run the branch up and down to break loose the hard stuff. But I've since learned a neat trick. I use a stainless steel kitchen scrubby, and I will take a stick and I'll lash this to the stick. Just take a string or a piece of paracord or whatever and tie this to the stick and then scrub the inside of the stovepipe. It works quite well. Okay, a lot of the modern stoves have glass in it. And that glass can be pretty nice, especially when it's soot-free. How do you clean it? I will, in the door, it's handy, even while it's running, to open the door, take a paper towel, wet it a little bit, dab some ash on that paper towel, and then you might want to hold it against the stove, warm it up a bit. I don't know if you really need to, but it won't hurt. Warm that up, and then scrub the glass, inside of the glass. That ash will be a mild abrasive. Scrub it, and then take a dry towel and clean the ash off if you need to. So once I get home, what the ash won't clean up, I use the ash to also clean up the side windows after I get home. But what it won't clean up, I use an old-fashioned razor blade window scraper. It works great. You'll want to be careful that you don't scratch the glass. Don't get aggressive with it. Just be real careful and always keep it flat when you're scrubbing the glass. Now, as I said before, as far as features, I really like glass in the door, especially. I also really like side shelves. Now, there's a couple other features that I found pretty handy. One is this hot water heater. This is made for going around the stovepipe, or hanging on the side here. And then it has a spigot for dispensing the water once it's warm. Now another handy feature, this is the winter well stove. Another handy feature is a breakdown oven. I really like this as well. This is called their fast fold, I believe. You use these tabs here to lock it in place. And it has shelves that go in here. I don't have them in here right now. And then you put on the top here and lock it in place with tabs, just like you did on the sides. Now this can be used on top of any of these larger stoves. It has a glass and temperature gauge. I've found that to be really handy, this an oven. Now, do you need something as expensive and fancy as this? No. No, you can make it out of a couple of pots. You know, flip one pot upside down on top of another one, put a smaller pot inside, there's your oven. This is just handy, the size of it. Now let's discuss stove jacks. This is a homemade stove jack. You can buy pre-made stove jacks, but this, I made it out of a welder's fiberglass blanket. I cut it out a little bit larger than I needed, folded over the edges, and then sewed it, and then put Velcro strips on. This half has the hook portion of the Velcro, the loop portion I put on the tent. Okay, now this is, if you want to make a tent like I did, I've made several, and you can see the links to those below the video here. Or if you want to turn an old tent that you already have, turn it into a hot tent. Cut out the hole appropriate for the size of the stove jack you have, and then I sewed the loop portion of the Velcro to that. So now I put this on. I have a stove jack. I can put on different stove jacks with different size openings for the appropriate stove that I'll be using, different size stove pipes. Now, it is important that you size this to the size of stove pipe, because as it gets heat, as you're producing heat and you're warming up the tent, that heat's going to go up to the top of the tent, and then it's going to slowly build down until it gets to your stove jack opening. If you have a large gap between your stove pipe and the opening here, that heat's just going to build down, and then it's going to escape right out of the side of your stove jack here. And you're not going to experience as much warmth down near the floor where you are, where you're sitting, where you're working, where you're living. So it's important to have a fairly snug stove jack. You can see how I made this stove jack in a link below the video. Okay. You can also see how I made several of the stoves, homemade wood stoves, in the link below the video. Now, let's discuss stove baffles. Why you might want one. I like them personally. In this particular stove, as I already mentioned, it has a baffle that starts somewhere in this region, right up against the front here. It goes to the back and ends about in here somewhere. The stove exhaust will go back here, come up, and then it'll flow all along the top here and out the chimney. That serves two purposes, at least two purposes. One, it produces quite a nice cooking surface for cooking on, because all of that heat is running right along the top instead of coming from your fire towards the stovepipe up and out. So it produces a much better cooking surface. Another useful feature of stove baffles is that it's a hot chamber up here, that it's an extra distance that any sparks produced down here have to travel all this distance. Rather than coming straight up into the pipe, it has to travel all this distance to then go up the pipe and out. It helps to burn up. It's a hot area up here that helps to burn up those sparks and prevent them from going up the pipe and falling down on top of your tent. Now, speaking of sparks, one thing you want to be careful when using a hot stove in a hot tent is don't burn any garbage in your stove. Burn only wood. Too often, paper or light objects like that will tend to go up your chimney as a spark and will drift down on your tent and burn your tent. So it's a good idea when using a hot stove in a hot tent, burn only pure wood only. Well, thank you for joining Connie and I on this video. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you learned something, and we appreciate you folks. We'll see you on the next video, and you take care. If you enjoyed this video, be sure and give it a thumbs up and to share it, as well as subscribe so you don't miss any more. And check out these suggested videos here. Thank you.